In 1913, eminent biochemist Dr. Lawrence Joseph Henderson noticed something of a sore thumb sticking out in regards to life on Earth. It's not merely just here, rather it exists under very specific fundamental circumstances, such as the need for the presence of liquid water, which also means the need for the right temperature and so on. And in his book, The Fitness of the Environment, Henderson highlighted that question that subsequently defined our search for habitable exoplanets and our study of the solar system to this day. The importance of liquid water for life as we know it cannot be understated and all that comes with it. Without it, no life could exist on this world. And that's not even touching chemistry, just the solvent in which it can happen. And from there it got worse as subsequent science found a number of other variables much greater than simply Earth's conditions as an exoplanet, such as gravity, electromagnetism, even the existence of cohesive matter itself, had to have the values they do just for life in the universe to exist. And there are a lot of them. It continues, if certain circumstances hadn't been met, none of this would be here, living or not. The universe must be tuned just so for even matter to exist, much less life. Even an atom of uranium faces the fine-tuning problem, and it has little to do with biology. What parameters were needed for uranium to be able to exist? Why do the parameters needed for elements heavier than uranium to persist longer than a short time not exist? And there's so much more. This is a very weird universe indeed. Another example of oddness would be the amount of matter and antimatter produced by the Big Bang that had to be slightly asymmetric, or all matter and antimatter in the universe would have annihilated almost immediately after the Big Bang, and there would be nothing here. If dark energy has a relation to mass, such as if it's being created by black holes, even the expansion of the blackness of the universe and the onset of time, if it really exists in that context, wouldn't have happened. Everything would have been a Big Bang blip, for which no measurable trace would exist anywhere. It may be that failed universes might well never have happened, for there is no one that could ever know about them. This cauldron of chance occurrences and the values of the laws of the universe that allow it to exist, from one perspective, can look very strange indeed. But from another, it can actually look rather mundane. On the other hand, the argument has been made for some type of intelligent design, and that these parameters and occurrences were baked into the universe, defined as a creation. Whether you subscribe to that interpretation of nature is up to you, but a variant of this is the simulation hypothesis, where whatever or whoever created the simulation, if anyone actually did, set the rules in motion, but may then leave it alone. A quasi-creation, running on autopilot, or not running on autopilot. But on the opposite side of things is the multiverse concept, which requires none of that. If there are other universes than this one, then it's not surprising that a few would just happen to have the parameters needed for life. But most universes simply do not. If the multiverse is infinite in the number of universes, then there are infinite amounts of habitable ones and uninhabitable ones. All is possible there, more on that later. Either extreme, however, requires some rather big assumptions. On the one hand, an intelligent creator, and on the other, multiple or even infinite numbers of universes for which we have no observational way to prove even exist, or from which to even suspect they exist. And there's even the possibility that, for reasons unknown to us, it may simply be that there was no other physical way for a universe to be. Remember, the universe is all that is, ever was, or ever will be. Not so in a multiverse, where presumably a nothing somehow defines the conditions of a something. But there seems to be little hope of ever measuring anything outside of our own universe. It's even been advanced that the universe isn't a simulation or a creation, but rather an artificial tweaking of nature by a highly advanced alien civilization that perhaps as their own universe grew ancient and dark, created this one to their parameters and needs in a lab to provide an escape. And we are merely a tag-along result of the factors they set for their own continued existence. As unsatisfying as all that is, and frankly ambiguous, it's what we're left with when confronting the fine-tuning problem. There is no easy natural explanation that's been forthcoming to make the question itself mundane. Worse, in confronting the fine-tuning problem with one of the few ways we can, the Large Hadron Collider, it was expected that we'd see evidence of new physics that might ultimately provide some insight. We didn't. at least so far. And it pays to remember here how the question of the fine-tuning problem is posed. It's often anthropic in nature, a product of human thinking, so it pays to remember that the universe is not fine-tuned for us. That's a mistake. We are life, but we don't define it. And we weren't here for the vast epic majority of the universe's existence, and the epic half-vast majority of the history of life on Earth. We are just one variation of life that arose on planet Earth, so we must not be tempted to assign some special significance to human consciousness in this question. That's an entirely different can of worms, and the nuts and bolts must be tackled first. What's astonishing is that the universe produced not merely life, that's the end result, but the chemistry for life. So not only does the universe provide suitable environments for life, it produced water and the precursor organic chemistry of life. Compare that to the parameters and interactions of other chemistry. You won't find gold-based life because it's very non-reactive. It just likes to be gold and not incorporate itself into bears and fish. Similarly, you won't find helium of much use in biochemistry. Granted, there are known reasons for why this is in practical science, but the fundamental underpinning that sets the properties of the particles that make them up are generally unknown. And there is much more. Change the value of the charge of the electron or the ratios of the masses of the proton and the electron, and it all falls apart. Change the value of the strong nuclear force, and the hydrogen fusion in stars would produce a completely different outcome than helium. Stars as we know them would be radically different. So much so that it's possible the universe's hydrogen might have been completely exhausted not long after the Big Bang, though this is still a subject of some debate. Think stars that last seconds, and then it's done, rather than millions, billions, or trillions of years as the various classes of stars as we know them do. To confound this even more, we don't even know exactly how many parameters or constants there actually are that define the behavior of the universe. Particle physics right now has about 25, all fatal to existence if they were even slightly different. But general relativity adds an even weirder one, the cosmological constant. Change that one and you mess with the rate of the expansion of the universe. Despite coming up with it, Einstein never liked the idea of a cosmological constant. And who could blame him? He concocted it to conform to a consensus he liked. You see, at the time, the prevailing idea in cosmology was that the universe was static. It was something that had always existed and never really changed much. It was always there, was here in his time, and always would be. Then a wrench was tossed into the works. And it was tossed in before Einstein actually came up with relativity. It just wasn't noticed. It comes back to work done around 1912 by astronomer Vesto Slipher, who determined that the light from distant galaxies was red-shifted. The light was being stretched by the motion of those galaxies away from us. Strange indeed. Then Edwin Hubble discovered that the universe was expanding, working on that and other previous work. Thus came Big Bang cosmology and the abandonment of the cosmological constant. Einstein called it his biggest blunder, but strangely, the idea came back in force with the notion of dark energy driving the expansion of the universe, but in a different form than Einstein had envisioned. We now deal with a new but related cosmological constant over a century later, and we know very little about it. We don't yet fully understand the implications of messing around with the possible parameters of the properties of dark energy, but they could be huge. We just know that its ultimate value must be small, but make it larger, then what happens? Bad things, and this highlights how much we really don't know about physics and how our different theories regarding aspects of it interact. As a result, we don't know enough about what could set the parameters of the universe. And there are many other issues. We have no real idea, for example, why gravity is so incredibly weak compared to the other apparent forces of the universe. That's one of the major confounding aspects of physics today. Gravity on the subatomic scale is almost non-existent. Indeed, you need the entire mass of this planet to hold you where you are. But play with the parameters. If gravity had been slightly stronger in relation to dark energy, the universe would have collapsed before planets and life could have ever formed. Yet if it were too weak, stars couldn't have formed at all. It would be a universe of slowly coalescing clouds of gas. Its value is sitting where it is in what could be called a sweet spot, which is rather odd. You could play with other questions. What if the universe had more or less dimensions than it does? What does that do? Well, this is also unknown. We don't know how many dimensions it has. What if there were two dimensions of time, as opposed to one? The parameters and questions are many, yet when we look at the universe, everything appears to be just so to allow for life. But again, it's fully possible that there just isn't any other way a universe can be, and the conditions of how this unfolds may become clear with a fully unified theory of everything being achieved, if ever. It may someday make perfect sense with a complete enough picture. But back to the idea of an alien species from another universe creating this one in order to colonize. That has some strange implications that have a certain plausibility that can't be easily ignored. Some scientists believe that all of nature can be duplicated if you have the ability. Indeed, we do that all the time, and we improve on it. Nature produced a horse that can run, and in turn, on the same principles of motion, humans produced locomotives with thousands of horsepower. Nature allows for movement, thus movement can be reproduced by humans. If that scales up to the creation of universes, which nature clearly did, then it's not inconceivable that humans or alien species with advanced enough technology could create a universe of their own, with whatever parameters they required so they could inhabit it. This might lead to chains of habitable universes, all artificially created. One leads to a second, that leads to four, and so on, exponentially creating a multiverse of artificially created habitable universes, stemming from an initial, natural one. In this case, there could be trillions of habitable universes branching off from each other, all artificially created, and equally habitable being based on the same parameters. As if our universe wasn't large enough, one wonders if that leads to a way to travel between identical or at least similar universes and survive the trip. As a result, a solution to the Fermi paradox comes into play here. It may simply be that once a civilization achieves an advanced enough technological level to create an ideal universe for its population, it does that, and then it leaves its parent universe entirely. In short, you could call it the no one needs the real estate solution to the Fermi paradox. We never see them because they leave not long after they become visible, and so will we, perhaps soon. But there's more, and it's bad. So far as we can tell, at this point, the geometry of the universe appears to be flat. In other words, a line of two parallel railroad tracks will never meet, no matter how far across the universe they stretch. There are different ways for that to unfold, but one of them is the infamous infinite universe hypothesis. If our universe is infinite, and any universes spawned from it are infinite in their own way, then the implication is that all things that are possible will happen. If that truly is the case, then not only do other copies of almost exactly Earth and almost exactly you and I exist in this universe, but it also happens in other infinite universes working on the same rule as well. That in turn opens up a rather disturbing possibility. I'd normally save this kind of video for Spooky October on this channel, but on a cold Northern Hemisphere dark February night, writing at 2:40 in the morning as I often do, I thought it might be fun to ask this question. What if the universe itself is a technosignature? And what if it were made by humans, not aliens, from another universe entirely? What if it's not turtles all the way down, but humans? And it all stretches back to some dead from the start universe of infinite blackness and time, where a Boltzmann brain once appeared randomly in the immense, crushing nothingness of such a place, and wondered if it just changed some parameters and created a new universe, what might be possible? Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently a bit chilly even here in the heated Event Horizon studio. Wasn't lying about the cold February night, and there have been a lot of those this year compared to normal in my area, which gets cold anyway. But there's nothing like looking up at the crisp, clear, cold winter sky and wondering what might be out there. Even if in a city you can still see a few stars, it's still enough to wonder about. So stay curious and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we dream.